good morning, church. It's great to be together this morning. We've gathered in this place to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Lord of all creation. I'm going to read a call to worship that actually comes from our sermon text this morning, the first two verses of Isaiah chapter 66. And as I read these two verses as our call to worship, I want you to listen for three things. These are the three things that we'll be singing about all morning long together. One, that God is King. He's on his throne. Number two, that he is the Lord of all creation. We are all his created beings. And number three, that we are to respond to him with humble obedience. So these three things, two about who God is, one about how we are to respond to him. And I invite you to stand as I read our call to worship, Isaiah 66, verses 1 and 2, and then we'll sing. It says, "Thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What is the house that you would build for me, and what is the place of my rest? All these things my hand has made, and so all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word." Let's praise him together this morning.
Yeah. Good morning, RBC. Before we pray as a church this morning, I want to give you an update on the youth and how our summer is going. Every week this summer, the youth group has been using our Wednesday nights for discipleship training. 1 Timothy 4:7-8, that's been our theme, and it says, "Train yourself for godliness, for while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come." So we've been using Wednesday nights to train our students for godliness. Every week we come and we give the students 10 assignments to complete for the next week, and then they go and do the work and come back the next Wednesday and we review it and talk about what we've learned from it and then do it again the next week. And we're in week 8 of that now. Of course, right, doing all of these assignments doesn't automatically make us godly. God is the one who does that, but because God has saved us through his grace by Jesus, as his children, we love him, right? And we want to discipline ourselves to seek him and to please him. And for students who complete the training, they're eligible for one of our 4 trips. And our first trip just got back on Friday night. Our second trip leaves this afternoon. Our first trip from last week was with our freshmen in high school. We went to CEF headquarters just outside St. Louis, Missouri, and we did work projects for international missionaries on that campus. And it was a great trip. We had 25 students and 9 leaders, and for 4 days we did a wide range of work projects, from packaging up gospel books to send to missionaries in over 200 countries around the globe, to digging out a French drain and pouring a concrete slab to keep up the grounds there. It was really incredible how hard our students worked. They served well and had great attitudes. But for me, the highlight of the week was meeting together for an hour and a half to 2 hours every evening after dinner and studying God's word together in our devotion time. We would sing and pray and talk about the Bible, both in large group and then in smaller groups. And God was gracious and gave the students really soft hearts. We got to see spiritual transformation happen right before our eyes. And I'd love to drone on and on about all the good things we saw God do this last week, but let me give you 5 quick highlights from the week, all right? 1, I love the youth leaders. They were fantastic. Along with me, we had 8 youth leaders who volunteered their time and took off of work and their jobs to go work in the heat of Missouri. When you work a regular job and you get 3 weeks of vacation, it's hard to take one of those weeks and use it to do work projects, but they did. And they did it because they loved these students. These leaders poured their lives into the students, discipling them and staying up late into the night to share Jesus with the students. 2nd highlight, I was talking with one student on the last day about what God was teaching him on the trip. Here's what he said. "I need to walk in the light. I am struggling with sin. I have bad friends I hang with. This week I brought my sin into the light, and I need accountability to keep me in the light." And I asked him, "What should I tell the church about this on Sunday?" Thinking of right now. And he said, "Tell them not to be afraid to tell other Christians about your sin. Bring it into the light." So encouraging. 3rd highlight. In one small group, we were talking about envy. We went around sharing things we get envious of in other people. And so we would share things like, "I'm envious of the money other people have, or the video games other people have, or the friendships, relationships people have." Then one girl shared, and she's relatively new. She said, "I'm envious of this girl's relationship with Jesus. I'm just starting to learn about Jesus, and I know I don't have a relationship with Jesus like she does, and I want that." So, wow. 4th highlight, prayer. One of the coolest parts of the week is that as we serve together, people start to open up about their lives. And as they did, students and leaders were quick to pray for each other right there on the spot. I saw dozens of times during the week where people just stopped and prayed in the middle of the day and asked God for help for what was going on. And last highlight is more something that just stood out, and it's this. Everyone is hurting. One of the leaders, Eric Neidefer, said something that stood out to me in small group. He was just talking about how rare it is for us to initiate spiritual conversations with each other. We'll kind of, it's okay to talk about everything else, but then to talk about Jesus seems hard. And if we do, then usually we just get kind of a generic answer, right? I'm doing fine. And then he said, man, listen, 25% of the time I'm fine. People aren't fine. People are hurting. And we need to care enough to get in there and help. And it struck me, he's right. People are hurting. And like the rest of us, many of our students are hurting. We heard of students struggling with doubt, struggling with temptation, struggling with family problems, with friend problems, with health problems, with spiritual problems. And people who are hurting need Jesus. And they need other hurting individuals who love Jesus to come alongside them, point them to Jesus. God was so gracious, giving us so many just fantastic conversations and spiritual opportunities. And we're eager for more. This afternoon, we have 30 of our high school sophomores and juniors heading to Camp Ripley. The third, fourth, and fifth graders who are the campers are coming out tomorrow. So please be praying for safety and for soft hearts and for repentance in the students and even for God to save people through this trip. They'll be there all week. They come home Friday. So if you think of it this week, please be praying for that trip. And we'll hear next week in Big Church how God answered those prayers. So with that, let me pray for us now. Father, I want to thank you so much for the many good gifts that you gave us as a church this last week on our trip. Thank you for continuing to finish the good work that you have started in their hearts. And thank you for forming Christ in us through these work projects and through the times in your word. God, for the students who are hurting here and God, for the rest of us who are hurting here, I pray that you would be near to us and show us more of your glory today. And do the same at Camp Ripley, Father. Be glorified through students being born again. Be glorified through students turning from sin and turning to Jesus who died for us. We humbly ask for your hand of blessing on the trip, Father, for safety, for health, and for a week that is centered on Jesus. And Father, use this service to tune our hearts to sing your praise. We come here this morning with our hearts bent towards sin. Straighten us by your word as we sing it and hear it and go out into the world and live it. Help us, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Such an encouragement to hear what the Lord's doing in our youth and through our youth. We're going to invite you to stand again to sing as we continue to sing of the Lord as King, the Lord as Creator, and we as his humble creation. So let's worship him together.
Oh, praise thee, hallelujah. I belong to the Lord, oh, I am Let's pray. Lord Jesus, all that we need is not in me. It's not in us. It's only found in you. Lord Jesus, you are still the bread of God, the living bread come down from heaven, of which the manna was just an earthly picture. Lord Jesus, surely you will still feed your church, for we are still wandering through the wilderness down here below. This is a dry and weary land. Lord Jesus, you and you only are the living water, the living bread. Feed us now by your word. We receive your word as our very life. Jesus, in your name, we ask this blessing upon the preaching of your word. Amen. Amen. We're in the last chapter of Isaiah this morning, Isaiah 66. We'll finish our series on Isaiah after I complete my 18 sermons out of Isaiah 66. We'll just be here twice, Lord willing, today and next week, and then we'll be done. Isaiah 66. And then after we're done with Isaiah, I'm going to do a, Lord willing, I'm going to do a short, like, topical series. And I'm just going to take the three or four questions that I've been most frequently asked in the last couple of years and answer them from the word. Practical questions about how to navigate through this crazy world and everything that's going on around us. And then after that, we'll start another expositional series. But this morning we'll be in Isaiah 66. We're going to read from verses 1 down through verse 14, and then we'll do 15 through the end of the chapter next week. And what I want to do this morning in the sermon is I want to just read through this text and give some explanatory teaching notes. And then after I do that fairly quickly, I'm just going to give two pastoral applications. And the first one, my goal will be to take you down as low as I can get you. And the second one, my goal will be to lift you up as high as I can get you. But first, we'll do a kind of explanatory and interpretive reading of this text. We'll read through it and stop and make a couple of comments as we go. So we're beginning in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 1. Thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What is the house that you would build for me? And what is the place of my rest? All these things my hand has made, and so all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit, and trembles at my word. A couple of comments about verses 1 and 2. Wonderful, wonderful verses. They start with the statement that the whole earth, how big is the earth compared to you? Even if your weight is a little more than you want it to be, how big is the whole earth compared to you? God says that whole earth is like my footstool, my footstool. Not only that, but he says, I made all these things. Verse 2, all these things my hand has made. God says, the whole earth is nothing to me, and everything that's made is something that I made. And so God says, what are you going to build for me? God created everything out of nothing. So how are we going to give God anything that isn't something that God has given us? Church, you do realize, we do realize that when it comes to serving God, we are just like a little kid, a four-year-old who has nothing and who says, Daddy, Daddy, can I have a dollar so I can get you something for your birthday? And God doesn't mind that. God doesn't mind that at all. Because if you look at the last phrase in verse 1, what is the place of my rest? That's the Sabbath rest. So speaking reverently, could we ask this question? Where is the place that God takes a deep breath and puts up his feet on his footstool and rests? This text answers that question. And it is an astonishing answer. It is certain human hearts. Wow. Which ones? The ones that are humble and contrite in spirit and tremble at his word. The text continues, verses 3 and 4. He who slaughters an ox is like one who kills a man. He who sacrifices a lamb like one who breaks a dog's neck. He who presents a grain offering like one who offers pig's blood. He who makes a memorial offering of frankincense like one who blesses an idol. Those who have chosen their own ways and their soul delights in their abominations. I also will choose harsh treatment for them and bring their fears upon them, because when I called, no one answered. And when I spoke, they did not listen, but they did what was evil in my eyes and chose that in which I did not delight. Here's the final reprise of a common theme in Isaiah, where God chides his people for their hypocritical worship. He's like, you're making these sacrifices, you might as well be wringing a dog's neck because it's worth nothing to me. Here's the last chapter of Isaiah. In the very first chapter of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 1, the very first thing God started with was the fact that his people, his children who he raised up, Israel, had rebelled against him and were offering hypocritical worship. Isaiah 1. Isaiah said, God said, hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. Children I've reared up, but they've rebelled against me. They are a sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity. From the sole of the foot even to the head, there's no soundness in them. He goes so far as to say, you are offering up sacrifices, but he says in Isaiah 1 verse 10, I do not delight in the blood of your bulls and your lambs and your goats. I'm not even asking you to appear before me. Bring no more these vain offerings, because when you bring them, your hands are full of blood. In Isaiah chapter 1, he began by chiding his people for hypocritical worship. And here in the end, he's saying the same thing once again. There are some who tremble at his word, but there's a vast majority who are hypocritical and who don't tremble at his word. And then verses 5 and 6 tell us how the hypocrites treat the genuine believers. Verse 5, hear the word of the Lord, you who tremble at his word. Your brothers who hate you and cast you out for my name's sake have said, let the Lord be glorified that we may see your joy, but it is they who shall be put to shame. The sound of an uproar from the city, a sound from the temple, the sound of the Lord rendering recompense to his enemies. Verse 5 says that those who tremble at God's word and those who offer genuine worship will be spoken against by the hypocrites and the powerful. This always happens. This always happens. Those who tremble at God's word and who are humble, here's what they find. They find the approbation and blessing of God, and they find the condemnation and cursing of the world. It happened then. It happens now. Jesus promised it. Jesus left no rose-colored glasses on anything. Jesus, like every other page, says, if you follow me, you will have the blessing of being reviled by many. Okay, Jesus, got it. Jesus says, blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil things against you on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who came before you. Jesus just marshals this truth from Isaiah and says it's going to continue until I return, Matthew 5. Jesus says, if you follow me, you'll have the blessing of being railed against by the hypocrites. And essentially, church, Jesus says, don't feel sorry for yourself when that happens. Don't feel sorry for yourself. And certainly don't let them speaking against you silence you, because your reward is great and I am with you. Text goes on, verses 7, 8, and 9. Before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before her pain come upon her, she delivered a son. Who has heard of such a thing? Who has seen such a thing? Such a land being born in one day? Shall a nation be brought forth in one moment? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she brought forth her children. shall I bring to the point of birth and not cause to bring forth, says the Lord? Shall I who cause to bring forth shut the womb, says your God? These verses talk about a reverse order of things. It's almost like before the birth pangs begin, the baby is born. This seems incredible. Yet, essentially, Isaiah is saying God will bring Israel back so quickly and so miraculously when the Messiah returns that it'll be like this. No one will have seen something like this happen until that moment. The point God is making with the picture of the birth pangs is that Israel's suffering will end with a miraculous and almost instantaneously joyous delivery. He's promising to take care of Jerusalem. Because look at the next verse, verse 10. Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her. All you who love her, rejoice with her in joy. All you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious abundance. For thus says the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. And you shall nurse and you shall be carried upon her hip and bounced upon her knee. A marvelous little gloss there about a little toddler, a chubby little toddler being bounced on a knee. God says, that's how I feel about my people. I'm going to take care of them. The people of God will become the standard of the world. You see how it says in verse 12? I'll extend peace to her like a river and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. All the nations will stream in and say, we want what Israel has. This is not that different than the way it should work with your Christian faith. I hope that you're the kind of Christian. I hope that I'm the kind of Christian that unbelievers see my life. They know I'm not perfect and they know that I've made my mistakes, but they see that I have a peace and I have a joy that the things of this world cannot touch, and they want that. They want that. Even in the millennial kingdom, that the nations will stream in to see how Jesus rules over Jerusalem. Then verses 13 and 14, and we'll end our reading at 14. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, your heart shall rejoice. Your bones shall flourish like grass, and the hand of the Lord shall be known to his servants. He shall show his indignation against his enemies. One of the reasons that verses 12 and 13 and 14 are so remarkable is because, you know, there are many times in Scripture where God compares himself to human things. He says he has an arm. He says he has a hand. And we know God's a spirit. He doesn't have an arm and a hand. He uses these anthropomorphisms or anthropopathisms to explain in language we can understand what God is like. But this is what's remarkable. Of that, I don't know the exact number, but of that vast number of comparisons that God makes of himself, something like 97% of them are masculine. This one's feminine. He compares himself to a mom who nurses the child and who carries the child on her hip. One of very few pictures of God where God is not only fatherly, but he's also motherly in the way that he comforts his people. That's our reading of the text with a couple of hopefully helpful explanations. I want to preach and apply this text in two ways. First, I want to take you as low as I can possibly get you, and then I want to exalt you higher than I could have ever gotten you before. So let's begin with verses 1 and 2. Humility receives God's word. Humility, low humility receives God's word. God says in verse 2, all these things my hand made, all these things came to be, declares the Lord, but this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word, the low humility of receiving God's word. Here's an invitation. There are maybe three aspects to it: humble, contrite in spirit, and trembling at his word. When God says, this is the woman, the man that I'm looking for. This is the woman, the man, so to speak, that God says, I find attractive. I find irresistible. I am looking for them. Those three qualities: humble, contrite in spirit, trembling at his word. What does it look like? Maybe the best way to describe it is to use more biblical language to describe it. Listen to how it's described in Isaiah 57, verse 15. Isaiah 57, verse 15. Thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly, to revive the heart of the contrite. That's Isaiah 57, 15. The spirit of the lowly and the heart of the contrite. Let me tell you another story in the words of Jesus that describe what this looked like. This story is coming from Luke chapter 18. This is what Jesus says. Two men went into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, one a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like these other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. When God saw the Pharisee exalting himself, God in heaven said, I find that unattractive. Get away from me. When God in heaven saw the tax collector humbling himself for mercy before the Lord, so to speak, God in heaven said, I find that attractive. Come to me and be my own. To this one I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Friends, humility is the one thing that God is looking for, the one attitude that works with him, that prevails with him. Trembling at his word is the one response that he's looking for. I'm going to lay out a simple binary. Sometimes teachers simplify things into two categories, and by their simplicity, they're distorting something that's more complex than that. I don't think this simple binary is a simplistic distortion. I actually think it's accurate. There are two ways to take the Bible. First way, I have me, my experience, my point of view. And I let my experience and my point of view and my me evaluate the Bible. And I receive God's word as it comes through the filter of me and my experience and the way I want things to be. Second way to receive the Bible. I receive the Bible with a humble and contrite spirit, and I tremble before it. And the Bible is so authoritative in my mind, in my heart, in my imagination, in my reflections about my past and my hopes for the future, that I judge my me and my desires and my judgments and my opinions and my experiences by the authority of God's word. Those are the two ways. I have my common sense and my way that I like to think about things, and that's the filter that God's word has to get through to be prevailing over me. Or I receive the word of God in a trembling fashion, which says from the heart, God, I've got the way I think things ought to be, and I've got the way I think, and I just know this, that the way you think is better than the way I think, and your revelation will give direction to my life better than the stirrings of my own mind. So lead me, guide me. You're my God. I'm clay. He's potter. God, I have my preferences and my hang-ups, but they all fall before you and your word. This is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. The supreme wisdom of Scripture is precisely found in this, that supreme wisdom is not found in the human heart. Supreme wisdom is revealed to the human heart by the external above authority of God's holy word. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I would sometimes be tempted to think, by the way that some people talk, that explaining my point of view to God is the beginning of wisdom. It's not how it works. Applying the right editing filter to God is the beginning of wisdom. Making sure God's up to speed on my preferences is the beginning of wisdom. Not so. The first trait of wisdom is that God is God and we fear him. God is God and we tremble before him. God is God and he is to be trusted. God is God and my heart is not to be trusted. So if humility is the attitude that God finds attractive, and trembling at God's word is the one thing that God himself responds to, then if I could back up this first point about getting you as low as possible with two practical steps for you to take. How do you do it? How do you move yourself toward trembling at God's word? Two steps to take, two moves to make. Number one, pray when you open the Bible. That's it. Pray when you open the Bible. The text for this point is probably the same text you would pick if you've been in this book for a long time, Psalm 119. Psalm 119, verse 18. Psalm 119, verse 18 says, "Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law." He's praying as he's opening the Bible. And then we can read together Psalm 119, verses 33 through 37. Almost, if not every single verse in Psalm 119, verses 33 through 37, is a prayer as you open the Bible. Psalm 119, verse 33. "Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Give me understanding that I may keep your law and observe it with all my heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at vain, worthless things and give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise that you may be feared. Turn away the reproach that I dread, for your words are good." You see how he's praying. Teach me, O Lord. Give me understanding. Lead me in your path. Incline my heart to your word. Turn my eyes from other things and on to your word. Pray as you open the Bible. Some of you, many of you, you pray for your friends' needs pretty all right, because you love your friends and it's easy to pray for their needs when they ask you to pray for them. And some of you, most of you, pray for your own needs pretty well. Because after all, if my tooth hurts, you don't have to remind me to pray to God to fix my tooth. It's like a need, like I'm praying for it. But if I could say, my guess is that some of you, perhaps most of you, you don't pray nearly enough about the one thing that it is most important to pray about. And that is your own heart. Your own heart. Your own spirit. Psalm 119, verse 37, "Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me a radiant appetite for the beauty of your word." You don't pray enough for your appetites. You don't pray enough for your desires and your heart and your spirit. When God says he wants that humble heart, the reason, the first move to make is to pray as you open your Bible is this. Catch this, because it's like the meta inside of the meta. Praying is not only a request for God to make you humble, and you should pray that God would give you a humble and contrite and trembling heart. Praying is not only a request that God would make you humble, but prayer in itself is an act of humility. Prayer in and of itself is an act of contrition. Because when I'm praying, I'm saying, I can't do this by myself. I need you to do it. I know that I need help that doesn't come from within. And so not only is praying for humility a good thing to do, praying for humility is actually an active step you can take in humbling yourself. We humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God by praying as we open His Word. So that's first, pray as you open His Word. Second, push against yourself as you open the Bible. Push against yourself as you open the Bible. And my text for this, push against yourself as you open the Bible, is this wonderful text in Proverbs 3, verses 1 through 8. I was here for the Pace Setters lunch on Friday, which was a lot of fun. And I was talking to somebody at the lunch, and he was telling me that the Proverbs 3 was his favorite verse, his favorite passage. Proverbs 3 says, "My son, do not forget my teaching. Let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and peace they will add to you. Let not steadfast love and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good success in the sight of God and man." Proverbs 3:5, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He'll make straight your paths. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil, and it will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones." Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. What does it mean to trust in the Lord with all your heart? The life of wisdom is not the life of mystical kind of mind-emptying leaps. Trusting in the Lord is, Proverbs 3, verse 1, do not forget His teaching. Proverbs 3, verse 1, letting your heart keep His commandments. Proverbs 3, verse 5, refusing to lean on your own understanding. Proverbs 3, verse 7, not being wise in your own eyes, but fearing and trembling before the word of the Lord. Wisdom, biblically speaking, is a persistent refusal of your own wisdom and a persistent obsession with God's wisdom. Wisdom is a consistent interaction with God's wisdom in Scripture and a consistent negative reaction against your own understanding and your own point of view without God. Interpretive paraphrase of Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Do not lean on merely human understanding. Stop listening to yourself. Stop giving the whispered voices of your own wishes authority in your heart. Instead, trust God enough to study and learn and depend upon His revealed word. Listen up to what God is saying in His word. That's what it means to trust the Lord. That's what it means to trust the Lord. And again, this is obvious. Maybe it's obvious, but I don't think we think about it nearly enough. When we trust the Lord, here's the Lord who we're trusting. Another verse from Isaiah chapter 55. God says, trust my thoughts, not your thoughts. Trust my ways, not your ways. Because God says in Isaiah 55, my thoughts are what? Not your thoughts. My ways are what? Not your ways. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, declares the Lord. So high are my thoughts above your thoughts, declares the Lord. Isaiah 55, verses 8 through 9. We should trust God when? We should trust God especially when what God says disagrees with our common sense. Some of the greatest truth found in Scripture is that truth's greatness itself is found in Scripture rather than in the imaginations of the human mind. Happy is the man or woman who is liberated from self and finds this blessed truth. Happy, happy are they. So that's the application of that first point of humbling yourself before the Lord. I want to get you down there low. Second, from verses 12 to 14 of Isaiah 66, I want to exalt you. Because after all, I would be ripping you off. I would be ripping you off if I said God's big deal in Scripture is humble yourself, period. It isn't. God's big deal in Scripture is humble yourself and what? God says, I will exalt you. And I don't want to leave you without that. I've wondered and even lamented a little this week. I wonder if in years past in my preaching I did that. I just pushed too hard on that humble. And I didn't put that and. God says, and I will exalt you. But he does. And I want to enjoy it together with you. See, Isaiah 66, verses 12 through 14, when you humble yourself, God will give you, verse 12, peace like a river. And God will be like a nurse to you, carrying you on his hip and bouncing you on his knee. See, it's like God's just going to pinch your cheek and say, that's my girl, that's my boy. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. You'll be comforted in Jerusalem. The literary artistry with which Isaiah put together his book. There's three big sections. The last big section is chapter 40 through chapter 66. And the inclusio from the beginning to the end of Isaiah 40 to 66. If you remember Isaiah 40, he says, comfort, oh, comfort my people Israel. And here as he brings it to an end in this third part of his oratio he's putting together, he says, comfort for God's people, comfort for God's people. He doesn't end by saying, humble yourself, period. He ends by saying, humble yourself and I'll comfort you. I'll exalt you. I'll lift you up. Church, God's glory will not crush the humble. Church, God's glory will crush the proud, but God's glory will not crush the humble. God's glory will redeem the humble and exalt the humble. If you've humbled yourself in repentance over sin, if you've humbled yourself by trembling at his word, then God looks at you with this exalting kind of love. He doesn't want you to grovel in the dust. He wants you to be with him as his daughter, as his son. This is the wonderful news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, there's no condemnation. Luke 18, that proud Pharisee who was like, I don't need Jesus, there's nothing but condemnation and humiliation for him. But that humble tax collector who says, I need Jesus, there is exaltation and liberation for him. Trembling at God's word. Therefore, church, a mature understanding of this is that trembling at God's word does not lead to a life of cringing and groveling and self-loathing, properly understood. Trembling at God's word is an attitude of repudiating my pride, declaring dependence on God, putting the kibosh on my own common sense and my own way of doing things and my own perspective, and receiving that God's wisdom is superior to mine, and believing God's word. And when you believe God's word, what you believe is that though we have sinned, his mercy is greater still. Some of the sweetest verses about this are in 1 John that we've just gone through in our ABFs. 1 John 3, verse 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father has given to us that we should be called sons and daughters of God. This is not a sort of groveling self-loathing. This is I am a child of the King, specifically not by my merit, but by the sin-bearing death of Jesus Christ. And so I'm loved by God. It's perhaps part of the meaning of the text that we're in. I think it's actually today in 1 John. I think you're in chapter 4 where you're gonna hit that verse. There is no fear in love. Interesting. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. I'm not sure what that verse means. I've got to go to your ABF and see what your teacher says it means. But at least part of what it means is that when you properly humble yourself before God, you do not spend your life as an insect groveling in the dust. It's not the case. It's not the case. God did not make Adam and Eve in order to crush them and humiliate them. God made Adam and Eve in order to love them and exalt them. God didn't make Adam and Eve and then say to them in the garden, the best thing you can do is loathe yourself and hate yourself forever and ever. God made the man and the woman to exalt them in relationship with him. And he did warn them, the worst thing you can do is to try to exalt yourself without me. The worst thing you can do is try to be exalted without humbling yourself before me. That's the worst thing you can do. That's the worst thing you can do. But to honor God, obey God, humble myself before God is the same as enjoying God's goodness forever. You tie this in with Jeremiah 9, right? Don't let the strong man boast that he's so strong. Don't let the wise person boast that they're so wise. But let them boast. Let them exalt. Let them be lifted up in this, that they know me and that I know them, that I'm their Savior, their Redeemer. So it leads me to come all the way back around to be like, I don't know, this is a simple illustration. If I played the violin or I played the piano or you play an instrument and everybody watched you play and then they said, that's great. You're a great musician. If you were to say, I'm not really gifted, but I just practice really hard. I don't know, that maybe to you that sounds humble. That's actually not really a humble thing to say. I'm not really gifted. I just practice really hard. If you grant me the biblical definition of giftedness, what if the humble thing to say is, well, I'm gifted. God gave me a gift. And I didn't deserve it. I didn't make it. I have a belly button. I didn't create myself. But God gave me a gift. And I want to use that gift to glorify God and to bring beauty and joy into the lives of the people around me. What a proper self-understanding. Ephesians 2, 1 through 10, like, by nature, children of wrath, we're as low as we can go. We're nothing but sin and dirt and dust. But God, being rich in mercy, so loved us that by grace we've been saved. And then you get all the way to verse 10, right? That says that once you are saved, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. This is the good news of understanding who we are and how God created us. See, if you believe God and you are humble and contrite before him and tremble at his word, then you will come to recognize that what his word says to you is, you are mine and I have created you on purpose for a purpose. Use the gifts and the talents that I've given you. Love me and love your neighbor with those particular gifts and talents. It is true that we are dust. And it is also true that we are much beloved dust. It is true that we have malformed ourselves and made ourselves ugly by our sin. But it is also true that Jesus Christ says, you are mine, and he beautifies us with his very love. So church, I want you to have this proper understanding of the exaltation that comes from the grace of God in the gospel, because that will deliver you from a distorted self-loathing, and it'll also deliver you from the dangers of self-absorption or self-aggrandizement, where you only listen to yourself and you don't tremble at his word. Humility is believing all that God has said about you in the gospel. Here in Isaiah 66, God says he's got this plan to bring peace to Jerusalem on the cosmic scale in the whole eschatological time frame. But he also has this unique plan for you that his work and his gospel work in your life will humble you to receive the Savior and then exalt you to walk in the light and the love that the Savior has for you. So listen to him, church, and find the joy of trembling at his word. Let's pray. Living God, we praise you for this, your word, which you have spoken to us. We receive it with humility and with faith. And so now we ask that where our thoughts betray us, we ask that you would change the way we think, transform it. We ask that where our regrets and our failures weigh us down, that by the grace of your gospel, you would deliver us from condemnation. And we ask that where there are good works prepared beforehand for us to walk in them, we ask that you would lead us into those good works by your grace and for your glory. Be exalted in the life of your church, we pray. Amen.
Cause your word to come alive in me.
And now, church, may the Holy Spirit, the living breath of God, write with indelible assurance in your heart the love of God the Father in the life and death and resurrection of the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, for you, by his grace and for his glory. Amen.